Hear the words of the psalmist. Be still and know that I am God. And hear the words of Jesus as recorded by Matthew. I will be with you always until the end of the age. The God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob is with us, and we welcome you to the celebration of the life of Mark Charles Johnson. I do want to thank all of those that are part of today's service. Thank you so much for being a part of this. And on behalf of Mary and Allison and Monica and Anne and their extended Johnson family, thank you all for being here to celebrate the life of a dearly beloved man, husband, father, grandfather, YMCA leader, peace activist, poet, man of life. All of us being here today is a recognition of the remarkable person Mark was. We come from different places, but we are bonded by a common thread, and that is to honor the life of an extraordinary man who served this community so beautifully for so long. As we gather, it's important for us to lift up those people who are dotted around the country and around the world who are not able to be with us today but are with us in spirit. I think of John Noel Bassine, who would love to be here, but because the border is closed and Canada is not able to be with us. And many others come to mind. We thank them for being with us in spirit. And also, this service is being videotaped and will be available on Silver Bay's YouTube channel. We gather to give thanks to God for the life of Mark Johnson, for the blessing that each of us feels in having had the opportunity to know Mark. And second, we are here to support one another, to be there for one another in our grief, especially for Mary and the whole Johnson family who have lost a beloved member. This is one of the things we do best at Silver Bay, is to rally around families, is to support one another in loss and grief. And we also do something really well here, and that is celebrate lives. And Mark's is a life to celebrate. And so truly, as we gather in this auditorium and celebrate the life of Mark Charles Johnson, what a remarkable man. What an opportunity for us to lift up his spirit. What an opportunity for us to hear music and story and song and in so many ways just remember and celebrate Mark's life. A little bit later in the service, there'll be an opportunity for each of you, as many as we can, who might share a thought or a story or a humorous moment or a touching moment that you'd like to share with all of us. We'll have a microphone to run around, and please, if you'd love to share something, I know the family and we would all love to hear something that you would like to share about Mark. So as we sing together, as we share together, as we pray together, as we cry together, as we laugh together, we are each invited to open our hearts to the beauty and the love that has gathered us together in this place today. This beautiful auditorium that Mark so loved. We put Mark's ashes with family this morning in the memorial garden, the garden that he created. We lifted up his life, his spirit. Fascinating to put the creator of the garden in the garden. Mark so loved and dedicated so much of his life to this community and many others, and that in remembering Mark's life, our lives might be enriched and uplifted by his spirit. So, I hope you open up your hearts and the opportunity to feel Mark's spirit with us. We certainly give thanks for his life. And I would like to invite Monica Johnson Belvedere to offer an opening prayer, a Mohawk prayer of thanksgiving.
To be human is an honor, and we offer thanksgiving for all the gifts of life. Mother Earth, we thank you for giving us everything we need. Thank you, deep blue waters around Mother Earth, for you are the force that takes thirst away from all living things. We give thanks to green, green grasses that feel so good against our bare feet, for the cool beauty you bring to Mother Earth's floor. Thank you, good foods from Mother Earth, our life sustainers, for making us happy when we are hungry. Fruits and berries, we thank you for your color and sweetness. We are thankful to good medicine herbs for healing us when we are sick. Thank you, all the animals of the world, for keeping our precious forests clean. All the trees of the world, we are thankful for the shade and warmth you give us. Thank you, all the birds in the world, for singing your beautiful songs for all to enjoy. We give thanks to you, gentle four winds, for bringing clean air for us to breathe from the four directions. Thank you, grandfather thunderbeams, for bringing rains to help all living things grow. Elder brother sun, we send thanks for shining your light and warming Mother Earth. Thank you, Grandmother Moon, for growing full every month to light the darkness for the children and the sparkling waters. We give you thanks, twinkling stars, for making the night sky so beautiful and sprinkling morning dewdrops on the plants. Spirit protectors of our past and present, we thank you for showing us ways to live in peace and harmony with one another. And most of all, thank you, Great Spirit, for giving us all these wonderful gifts so we will be happy and healthy every day and every night.
And so we're going to sing this beautiful hymn that Mark so loved. Lord, you've come to the lake shore. It's number 344 in your hymnal. Let us stand and sing these four beautiful verses.
To follow. Micah 6:8. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Galatians 5:22-23. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such things there is no law.
Jack Grandshaw.
Matthew 5:6-9. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God.
What he was, he was. What he is fated to become depends on us. Remembering his death, how we choose to live will decide its meaning. When a just man dies, lamentation and praise, sorrow and joy are one. Thank you. the child of spring. Spring is the mother of May. May is the sister of love, who wakes at the dawning of June. Summer is mother of all fall and the rustle of leaves, strong are the seedlings of truth that grow in the seasons of peace.
Thank you, John and Richard. I would like to invite now Brian and Allison to come forward for some family remembrances.
No, this is not going to be as dramatic as what you just watched. And I think it deserves, especially including Randon, who I listened to that song when I got back from our trip with Mark, and I sent it to Randon and asked if he could play it today. And to me, it just shouts out Mark, the piano song. So, but thank you. Let's all. On behalf of the Johnson family, I would like to thank you for being here for this celebration. And I am the little Brian Johnson. I'm the little brother, who's not so little anymore. So I'm the youngest of the Johnsons that are here today. This little bag is kind of in remembrance of a couple things. My grandfather, our grandfather, on my mother's side, lived in downtown Rochester in an apartment. And he would come to see my mom and us boys on the weekends. And he would have a Wegmans bag, similar to this, coming off the bus. And his change of clothes and his toiletries would be in this. And he would walk from the, we only had one car, my dad was working. And he would walk from the bus station to our house. So that's in remembrance of him, that little bag. And it's holding. So I was asked if I could kind of talk about growing up with Mark. And so this little bag holds 192 Marwood Road. So this is, my grandfather was a builder in Buffalo. And obviously he built full-scale houses. Well, this is a replica of the house that Kirk, my middle brother, and I grew up in. It wasn't much bigger than this in reality. It was 900 square feet, and it sat on a little typical plot of land in suburban Rochester. Middle income, nothing changed. That house, if he went back to see it today, would look like that. So on the inside, and my grandfather actually made the little rooms. So the bedroom that the three of us was about a 10 by 10 room, and then my mom and dad's room. A kitchen, a little tiny dining room that eventually became a bedroom for Mark, and then a living room, and a bathroom with no exhaust fan. So that's where we started out. It's a little bit different because my brother was 9 when I was born. So Mark was 9 years older than I. My middle brother Kirk, that's here with us today, was 7 years older. So it's a different, you grew up in a whole different style. We didn't have the same friends, we didn't play the same games. Oh, it wasn't bad, it was just different to have a brother that was that much older. And a lot of my friends that had older brothers or older sisters, they somewhat became aunts and uncles or, you know, fathers or mothers to that little kid, that little one-year-old. But my brother never. was anything but a brother. Growing up, never yelled, never swore. He was very much like my mother. He was just a perfect good guy growing up. As you saw him and I hear people's stories about him late in life, he wasn't any different. Never lost his cool, never seen him lost his cool. He was just a good, good guy. You know, they say you're a product of your upbringing. And my mom and dad were just that. We are so fortunate to be surrounded by loving parents. It was just a very fortunate experience. I think the only thing I ever saw my brother do that had any little of a hint of maybe going to the dark side. And I'm praying that at the end of this, or when you can give some comment, especially to the kids to know a little bit about their dad, that you share something. And I hope it's something rotten. I'm hoping my brother cut you off on Route 9. Maybe threw some mashed potatoes against the wall in the cafeteria and he didn't think anybody saw him, but you saw him. So I'm hoping that that's short. This is the only thing that I ever remember. Again, when you're tiny and you're the littlest one in the house and you have this little bathroom that's 3 feet by 6 feet, Brian Johnson was number 5 in line. And if you couldn't wait, then you ran outside and you watered the flowers. But one time when I went into the bathroom, which I think probably I got in there around 10, there was a little mosquito that was smashed up on the wall of the bathroom. And I'm looking at it more closely and I see scotch tape over the mosquito. And I look even closer and there's words up there. Now I had to be 9 or 10 and it said, "Beware. You may be next." So as a little kid who constantly tried to stay out of everybody's shadow because I was that little kid, always fearful that I would get pummeled somehow, I looked at it and I said, I knew it was my dad. My dad was World War II. He would have just killed the mosquito and not put anything up there. My mother was so kind, she would have ushered the mosquito out. My brother, my middle brother, never wrote that clearly, so I knew it was So I knew it was Mark's writing, and in the beginning of his journalism career. And I looked and I said, is he talking to the mosquitoes that may come into the bathroom, or is he talking to me? So I stayed for the rest of my life in that home. I stayed out of his way. I never cut in line to go to the bathroom or use the bathroom. So that's it. That's the best I got out of 72 years of his life that I know of. So I'm hoping, again, that somebody rises to the occasion and can tell some terrible thing that he did. So, yeah, I was very lucky because Mark included me in his life. I go through 9 years older, so you got to remember. So when he's 9, I'm 1. When he's 18, I'm 9. So, and he went off to Worcester College. A very successful high school career, got lots of scholarships, went on. And it's just the epitome of a good kid. I mean, I would just scratch my head and ask, Mom, really? Is he adopted or something? Where does this perfect guy come from? There's got to be something. But he went on to Worcester College in Ohio, and he actually came back one weekend, and he took me to Worcester. And so you can imagine a college kid that the last thing he wants to do is drag his little brother to a college and to view it all and stay for the weekend, but he did that. And I must have been 12 or 13. When I was 15, my brother Mark and I convinced my mother and dad to let me go and meet Mark in Beirut, Lebanon. So here we are having a conversation with my mother and my dad and expecting them to say, get lost. I'm not sending a 15-year-old on a plane by himself. This is before cell phones and computers. It's not happening. Well, they said yes. So I immediately felt pretty worthless to my family that they would just ship me on. So I flew to New York City, and New York City to Paris, and then from Paris to Athens, and then Athens to Beirut, and I met Mark. And in 1971, Beirut was just the place to be, the Mediterranean. It was absolutely beautiful. And it was the first time I was to meet Mark's soon-to-be wife, Mary. Mary was going to the American University of Beirut. So I went over for 10 days. There was the expectancy of my trip. They were going to come back and get married in California that same summer. And unfortunately, on a trip, I had some water I shouldn't have had, and I ended up getting typhoid fever. So I ended up staying for a couple months, maybe an extra month, before the United States would let me back in. And to tie in a little story here, two of the people are sitting in the audience that I stayed with at their house when I was in Beirut. And that's the Jacobies. So Gail and Russell and their father, Walt and Joan Jacoby, I stayed with in an isolation period. But my brother, I was in the hospital for 11 days. My brother Mark came every single day. And he eased one, had to make the phone call or send a telegram to my parents that I was sick and wasn't coming back for a while. So my brother already had taken on that mature responsibility role and being that provider, that guider. When we came back, my father turned out to have lung cancer, and my brother was the one that told me that my father wasn't going to make it. That fall, and that he wouldn't make it till Christmas time. So my brother took on a lot of responsibilities, and he did so in the best of ways, in the most loving ways, and we were huggers, and I miss his hugs. They were so special. One time when he was getting his thesis done for Columbia, he got accepted into Columbia, and we, as life went on, we occasionally would meet at my mother's house in Rochester, and one time he brought in this thick book, and I'm sitting in the living room, and he flops it on my lap, and he says, "Hey, Brian," he says, "this is my thesis for my doctorate for Columbia." He says, "It's like around 700 pages, and I've got to get it down to 400 pages before I turn it in." So, again, this is a guy who started writing poetry, you know, like when he was two, and wrote 2,500 poems and used words that I had to carry around a dictionary to understand, and he flops it on my lap, and I look at it, and I read the first page, and I have no clue. I have no clue what this thing is. So I kept it for a little while, and I said, "You know, Mark, I would not change one word." I said, "If this doesn't get you your doctorate, I don't know what will." So I think he knew he had to go work on it. But he did get his doctorate, and that's why he's called Doc to all his grandkids. That's why they call him Doc. So driving in here, I feel Mark's presence. I've been coming here for a long, long time as a guest and visiting Mark up in Maple. And when you drive in here, this is the perfect resting place for Mark. You can feel it. My son Eric turned me on to a book called Lincoln in the Bardo. I don't know if you've ever read it. A Bardo is a place in between after death and rebirth. And it's a story in nonfiction that talks about Lincoln and his son Willie dying, and Lincoln going back to the mausoleum and holding Willie in his arms, not being able to believe that he died from typhoid fever. And he and Willie being in that, "I don't know where I am. Am I going onward or am I coming back?" And he'd walk right through Lincoln. And Lincoln could feel him there. And between Lincoln not ready to let Willie go, and Willie not willing to go, it finally, that's how I feel, and I hope that Marcus is here and we're letting him go. I'm hoping his family lets him go. I'm hoping you let him go. I'm hoping I let him go.
as he deserves it. He deserves to be in peace. And I know he's changed the lives of me, my brother Kirk, my family, his kids. And isn't it everyone's legacy that you can change somebody's life in a positive manner, regardless if it's for the environment, for social justice, for peace, or for just being a brother? I love you, brother. God bless. Thank you.
Supposed to end with a joke, so. I'm Allison, Mark's daughter. I have been reflecting on the ways I've followed in my father's footsteps. He was the oldest of his brothers. I am the oldest of my sisters by 1 minute. I grew up with two brothers, he grew up with two brothers and was father to all girls. I grew up with two sisters and now I'm mother to all boys. He went to the College of Worcester for his BA, and so did I. He went overseas to work, to Lebanon to work, and met my mother, Mary. And I went off to Mexico for a job and met my husband, George. Growing up in a house full of women, emotions could run high. And my dad was always calm, laid back, and pacifist. And these are all traits I tried to emulate. My favorite time in our family unit were our nightly family dinners. We spent a few months a year eating at the Silver Bay cafeteria, where I escaped my family and ate with my friends. But during the off season, we would spend almost every evening sitting down as a family for supper. We would share about our days and we would laugh. And countless times in the middle of a conversation, my dad would jump up out of his seat. He would be gone for less than a minute, come back with a book, open it up to a page, and read a passage that related to whatever we had been talking about. I was always so amazed by his memory. He was charming. He would walk into a room with a twinkle in his eye and a smile on his face. If he walked into an auditorium full of staff, he would know each of their names, and I'm sure he would know every single one of your names in here. If he walked into a party of strangers, he would learn all of their names. After moving to California, all my friends got to know him. After he moved to California, my friends got to know him by mingling at birthday parties and other get-togethers. And I was amazed how many people reached out to me after he died to share a conversation they had had with him and to tell me they would miss him. He was curious about nature and culture. Growing up, he would take us on little adventures. As a high schooler, I would roll my eyes at yet another gorge we were going to see that weekend. However, as an adult, I loved his search for new things and hidden gems. Each time he would visit me in LA, he would take me to a restaurant or a taco stand he had heard was amazing. And we would explore a part of the city I never knew existed, whether it was Waco Towers or a hike to a waterfall. I know his curiosity kept him going even after he wasn't able to visit all the places he wanted to still see. His desserts were fruit-filled. His favorite desserts were fruit-filled. As a family, we traditionally celebrated his birthday with strawberry shortcake. While he was executive director at Silver Bay, there was a run of summers where he would have a rhubarb pie contest every year for his birthday. And every Thanksgiving, he would make his famous apple pie. It's about the only thing he ever made, but he was good at making the apple pie. It's cliche, but although he's no longer alive, and we will never be able to sit and have a conversation or go for a hike, I see him everywhere. He's in every purple flower. He's in a spirit animal, the blue heron. He's in my oldest son, Jack, when he jumps up and grabs
a Diary of a Wimpy Kid book to read a passage about relating to our congregation. I recognize him in my nephew, Theory's curiosity as explores his surroundings and every animal he comes across. His love of music lives in my niece, Sophia, as she sat down to listen to the viola guitar concert last night. I see him when my youngest son, Charlie, walks into a room with a twinkle in his eye and flashes a smile. His sense of taste lives on in my nephew, Arlo, who will choose fruity desserts over chocolate. And his name lives on in his youngest grandson, Marco. My biggest regret of his passing is that this next generation won't get to learn more from him, but we will get to see what he left behind in them every day. Thank you.
Thank you, Brian and Allison. Other family? Any other family want to share anything? There'll be an opportunity when we pass mics around if you'd like to. So I would like to begin this eulogy with a piece of scripture that I think captures Mark, Revelation 21, 1-7. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throng saying, "Behold, the dwelling of God is with all people. God will dwell with them, and they shall be God's people. God will be with them. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain anymore, for the former things have passed away." And God, who sat upon the throne, said, "Behold, I make all things new." Also God said, "Write this, it's done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the fountain of the water of life. Those who conquer shall have this heritage, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." This so captures Mark. Mark saw a new heaven and a new earth and worked his whole life to create such. As Theo and Jack and Monica so beautifully read, Mark did what God asked him to do. Do justice, love kindness, and walk humbly with your God. Mark was filled with the fruits of the Spirit. Today in the garden, one of his daughters shared, they never heard him raise his voice. Three daughters never raised his voice. I have three daughters. I have fallen way short of this. Mark was filled with the fruit of the Spirit. Mark lived his whole life as a peacemaker. Mark certainly was one of God's people. Yes? Yes. So at the request of Mary and her daughters, again, Monica, Allison, and Anne, I am honored and humbled to offer this eulogy for Mark, one of my closest friends, whom I have known for 40 years. And like so many of you, Mark and I worked together, shared family together, rejoiced together, lamented together, cried together, laughed together, commiserated together, worshiped together, and shared the joys and the challenges of life together. And here at the beginning, I want to say something about Mary and her family. When we talk about Mark, the name Mary just naturally follows. Mark and Mary. They were a team in everything. It was always Mark and Mary. One of them would call us at the house. It would be either Mark or Mary. And I would say to my Sarah, "Oh, it's Mark and Mary." Even though it might have been Mark or Mary. They were just a team. You rarely saw one name or heard one name without the other. And I want to take a moment here just to lift up Mary and her daughters, Monica, Allison, and Anne, and brothers Mark, Kirk and Brian, and the entire Johnson family. Mary and her family's care and love for Mark over so many years, especially the last number of years when Mark was dealing with so many health issues, is a beautiful witness to their love for Mark and Mark's love for his family. Brian and Kirk, along with Sean, the grandnephew, drove Mark across country so Mark could live out the rest of his life in his beloved cottage in North Creek and be in the Adirondacks, a place he loved and called home. So I would like us just to take a moment to thank Mary and Allison and Monica and Anne and Brian and Kirk and the entire Johnson family for their love and care that they provided our dear friend Mark. Mary, would you and your family please stand so we can thank you for all that you have done for us and what you have meant to us. Please stand. Mark was the most faithful person I have ever known. Faithful to his family, to his friends, to his faith, and to the divine calling on his life. During his lifetime, Mark accomplished so much, achieved so much, produced so much, cared so much, and loved so much, and lived so fully. He did so in a response to an ethic that he was so committed to, an ethic that was central to who he was, an ethic that believed that together we can create a better world, together we can create a kinder world, together we can create a more peaceful world, together we can create a more sustainable world. Together we can create a world where all people are treated with dignity, where all people know hope, where all people can live in peace, where all people can know the abundant life and what the good book talks about. Mark was the most faithful person I'd ever known. And the word together, I repeated many times in that last phrase. Mark was a community builder in everything he did. He was always pulling us in. What do you think? Where should we go with this? What's your thinking? Where are we? That's why so many of us are here today. He pulled us all in, and he's doing it right this very moment. There are people here from 30 years ago, and people here from 20 and 10 and 5 and 8. Mark built community. And that's what we are today, a community of people that he pulled together to celebrate his life. He was always bringing people together. That was part of Mark's ethic, to create a better world by working together with all of us and many thousands of others to create a world that reflected the kingdom of God. And whether you were connected with Mark through the Fund for Lake George, the Lake George Association, the Park Commission, the Putnam Presbyterian Church, Lake George Land Conservancy, the National YMCA Movement, the Stony Point Center, the Fellowship of Reconciliation, the Silver Bay YMCA, or the Hague Fire Department, or any other organization Mark was part of, you knew as Mark that he was passionate and committed to working together to create a better world for everyone, everywhere. Mark and her family received hundreds of thoughtful sympathy messages, and we received a number at Silver Bay too after Mark's passing. And I'd like to just share three of them with you. The first one is from Ken Gladish. Ken Gladish was the former National Secretary General of the US YMCA, and Ken wrote this. By the way, I heard from Ken this morning and he said, please, please, just lift Mark up for me. Ken said this, there's no doubt that Mark's missional service is linked to the very best the YMCA movement has aspired to achieve throughout its history. Thank you, Mark, for your life of service to goodness, justice, and peace. John Michonis, through a communication he sent to the Lake George Land Conservancy, said this. John is with us today. Mark will long be remembered for his grace and wisdom and unfailing support of peace in our world, and for his passionate love for our environment. He is truly a Lake George hero. And Rabbi Arthur Waskow from the Stony Point Center wrote this: Mark was a brave, committed, and creative activist in the struggle for justice and peace and eco-sanity. And in the reawakening of the prophetic spirit, his memory is already a blessing, and may that blessing long continue among us. I so agree. May Mark's blessing, may Mark's prophetic vision, may Mark's brilliance and understanding to create a better world live through us ongoingly. You see, Mark's legacy is present in so many places, both here, locally, and far and wide. Here at Silver Bay, his footprint is all over this campus. He built the Children's Pavilion, Trinity House, Brookside Community House, the Memorial Garden, the Spiritual Life Center, the Water Storage Tower, the Gray Pavilion, additions at the gym and the boathouse, and renovations to the inn. And maybe the greatest environmental legacy is on that plaque at the end of Stone Point. If you haven't seen it lately, take a walk down there. That's Mark's legacy around the Margaret Boyd Rowan Preserve, which is that huge swath of land across the lake that's now forever wild because of Mark's vision. Mark was always the smartest guy in the room. He was keen and sharp and curious, but he never made you feel lesser and always brought you to a bigger vision, a clearer path, a higher calling. He was an accomplished poet, a great writer and speaker. Mark was clearly a leader, but he was a servant leader. He was a humble leader. He was a gracious leader. He led with courage and compassion and understanding and care. Mark was always about inclusion and always saw beauty. Mark so enjoyed being with people. He cared about people and loved people. I would step into his office of the number of years that he and I worked together. When somebody in the Silver Bay community had passed away, I would make sure to stop by his office and let him know who had passed. And every time I would say, so-and-so, I heard so-and-so passed away, he would get this pained look on his face, a sad look on his face, saying, oh no. And so he, as a Silver Bay member would leave us, he would just feel that pain of each family and what they were going through, because he knew them. He sincerely cared. Each summer, at the end of orientation, 225 M's show up to Silver Bay for orientation. They would go through the line the very first day and get their t-shirt, get their key, do this, do that, all the stuff they would get. And at the end, Mark would be there with somebody helping him, taking Polaroid pictures at every end. And then he would write down their name and where they worked. And the next day in his office, you would see four or five easels with all these Polaroid pictures on them. And he'd be standing in front of them, reciting them. John, boathouse. Bill, dining hall. By Friday, he could walk across the campus and say hello to anybody by name and know where they worked. Amazing. He cared. He sincerely cared. He personally knew so many Silver Bay members and families. And in September, when Mark and Mary came east, this is now this past September, to stay in their cabin in North Creek, a number of people asked how they could connect with Mark and Mary, and so they invited many people. Mary, you had hundreds of people come to see you at North Creek. And then a lot of people who couldn't make it there, Mark and Mary came down on a Saturday morning right out in front of this auditorium to anybody who would come by. And I thought a few people might show up. 60 people came to say hello to Mark and Mary 20 years after he'd left here. This man knew what it meant to love. With the support of hospice, Mark and Mary were able to live in their cabin 6 weeks before he passed, and Mark lived out his mission right up until the end. Being with him a lot during this time, I was taking notes. He asked me to bring a book that I was reading because he still wanted to learn. And so I was reading Richard Rohr's Universal Christ to him, and we were talking about it because he was still wanting to deepen and understand and be aware. And the phone that was right by his bed, there was a heart phone and a cell phone, and they would ring constantly. People calling to say hello, wish him well, find out how he was doing, share stuff with him. I wrote down notes in the back cover of my book of what he said. People calling to connect. Mark would say, "Hi, Michael. I'm fine. I'm enjoying this day. The word today, the word for the day is beautiful." That's a quote. This is 10 days before he passed. The word today is beautiful. And how are you? Kathy, your call is worth everything to me. How's your project coming along? Can I help you on the grant? To the very end. Mark did not want to die. We talked about it, but he was not afraid of death. He lived fully, working to support people right up to the end. He wanted to die on Indigenous People Day, which was a little ways off from where he was. He wanted to be in solidarity with people he supported and identified with and respected. And he struggled mightily to hold on. And when Mary woke up on Indigenous People Day, October 12th, and told Mark, "This was Indigenous People Day," he passed. I want to read a portion of a letter that I wrote to Mark when I knew the end was short. I'm not going to read the whole thing, just a few paragraphs. "Dear Mark, I want to share some thoughts with you as I sense our time together is short. You are the most inspirational person I have ever had the privilege to know. Your lifelong commitment to issues of peace and justice have been such a remarkable witness to what a good and right and true person you have been. You have never wavered. Your compassion for others is genuine. Your heartfelt and love is so real. Your care and love for others has been the defining characteristic of your life and your leadership. You really know what it means to love, my brother. Mark, you are the hardest working person I have ever known." Mark was the hardest. He'd leave the office here late, and he had this big satchel with him, and he'd walk to Maple, and you knew he was working that night after the kids went to bed. And he was always the first one in the office. It wasn't work for Mark. It was a calling. He wanted to make such a better world. I continue with my letter. "You gathered a team of people, many of them are here today, who we worked with back then, a team of people who truly enjoyed working with you and for you and with you. You cared about members, conferences, local people, EMPs. You knew all their names. Your ability to build relationships was remarkable. To this day, so many people in the wider Silver Bay community enjoy connecting with you, respect you, and love you. You created a culture at Silver Bay that was open, inclusive, and faithful, and fun. It was truly an honor to work with you. And I know so many others feel the same way who are here today with me. Mark, your vision and your courage, your joy and your compassion has been a remarkable witness to the man you are. Thank you for your friendship, your companionship, your support, and your love over so many years. I will miss you greatly, dear friend. Love, Bruce." He finished reading the letter, and both of us were just, of course, crying. And he held it to his heart for about a half an hour as he and I were together. And you know what? I believe that after Mark held that letter to his heart. I sincerely believe that we gathered here today celebrate his life, and that Mark is holding each and every one of you to his heart. His heart was big enough to hold thousands of people, and he cared, and he is holding you to his heart. He had such a big heart. He helped us to see something in us that we often couldn't see in ourselves. He made us all better people. He helped us find our better selves. He helped us find our highest angels. He brought out the best in us and in so many. He knew what it truly meant to love. And Mark was a joy-filled person, had a wonderful sense of humor, a hearty laugh. He would sometimes get laughing, we would get laughing, and he would start to cry. He was laughing so hard, and we could not stop. And there was a moment that I just want to tell you about. It was right on the stage. There was this skit we used to do as an administrative team. It was terrible. The skit was terrible. But it was so much fun to do with Mark. And we're doing this skit. And, you know, it's my Lutheran conference, there's 400 or 500 people here, lots of people around and all that. And Mark has his radio on his belt, because he was always listening to what was going to be going on, has radio on his belt. And we're up here doing this skit, and I don't know, we have to crawl around or do something. And there's a call for Mark on the radio, and you could hear it. There's a pipe burst in the inn. And so Mark, he's kind of doing this skit, doing his lines, and he's saying, "Put a rag in it. Put a rag in it." And the kid comes back and says, "It's a gusher. It's a gusher.
Get a couple rags. Get a couple rags."
He was trying to do anything he could to try to help this poor F out, who was on the third floor of the inn with a gusher. Oh, golly, it's just so funny. Mark, he just had such a tremendous sense of humor. He had a reverence for life. He held joy so beautifully. He lived so fully. I would like to just read, remember when you used to get a letter from Mark? You used to get a letter, and what would be in that, the first paragraph of the letter was always this beautiful prose thing. You remember getting those letters? I want to read one from you. December 24th, Christmas Eve, carols, candles, fill the chapel, voices with warmth abound as staff and neighbors share in celebrating this holiday of birth and renewal as we emerge into the brisk night. However, clouds covered the mountains and the lake like doubt and spirits dipped with the remainder of that night can be dark and may be uncertain. On this evening, a rare event, the only Christmas Eve full moon in 150 years was seen to maybe not be. But then, as we shared fairly wells outside the chapel, the wind shifted and the clouds parted to reveal a bright silver coin that moon soared overhead, and the full meaning of that night, an echo of an eternal choir, gifted from horizon to horizon. The night sky was again the source of a sign of grace abounding. Rare is the gift indeed. Golly, that just brings Mark back so powerfully. The gift indeed. Mark was the gift indeed to us. As the end was near, I asked Mark how he hoped we might celebrate his life. None of you will be surprised by his answer, and I quote, "I'm just a conduit. Celebrate each other's lives. I am just a conduit. Celebrate each other's lives." That's what he wanted us to do today. A conduit is a natural channel through which something is conveyed. Mark was an extraordinary, remarkable, beautiful channel through which goodness and justice, inclusion, peace, and love flowed through that channel Mark was. And that channel that Mark was in hope of creating a better world every day that he lived his life. And the best way for us to honor Mark to celebrate his life is to continue to be involved in the work that he dedicated his life to, in the work he inspired in each and every one of us. Mark was a beautiful conduit. And you, each of you, knew his love and care and compassion and support. You knew it. I knew it. Because he could so be it. He was that for all of us. Mark, what a beautiful man you are. Let us be conduits for Mark's life and spirit. Thank you, dear Mark. May you rest in peace, dear friend. We love you. Amen. That's for Mark. That is for Mark. Hey, I would like to invite Wendy Sternberg up, a dear friend of Mark's, who would like to read one of Mark's poems for us.
Thank you. I didn't know you were going to have a copy of the poem in the book, so I learned it off by heart, which was appropriate for Mark. And Bruce asked me if I wanted to come and rehearse it, and I said, oh no, I was out in the middle of Lake George in a kayak and belted it out loud. I just made sure the sailboats and the other kayakers were a little off to the side so people didn't think it was some crazy person in the middle of Lake George. One thing I have to say about Mark, Mark was definitely a soulmate of mine, and I was really blessed to know him. And I think he had this this concept that loss is not loss, it's just a transmigration to something else, to something a little bit more permanent perhaps, but not physically bound. And Mark came through on the hospice bus, and I'd like to thank Mary for the courage for letting him do this, and also all of his daughters who spoke today, and of course Anne too. And to Brian and Kirk, who came on this bus with all of the complications, including a toilet that didn't work for a period of time, and lots of other trials and tribulations. And Mark came into the restaurant, he had a walker, he had a catheter and a urine bag, and all of his talismans around his neck from the Native American community. And he walked in with this regal bearing. And that's really who he was. So this poem is a poem called Hell in the Light. It was written by Mark, and he read it at my mother's 19th Yahrzeit, which is the memorial in the Jewish tradition. And I read it in a program for my peace-building organization called Sounds of Healing, and I recited it out there for Mark, and this is for all of you. It's called Hell in the Light. This is the light I am being held in. Mysteries are manifold, so much I will never understand, and need not to be at peace, only rest in awe and gratitude. The heart beating in the quickened fetus, the signaling comet crossing the universe. There are no beginnings, no end, just endless beginnings, transformations, migrations of form and qualities, and conservation of energy. Time and space are constructs that put stardust in my bones. Words put into ideas follow laws outside of mathematics or alphabets. Many take great comfort in a story told a certain way. Consider it a truth. I celebrate them. For me, it is the word, where imagination is incarnated, given moral authority. Where possibilities are found, limitless. Beauty, in its brilliance, when it is named, lifts my soul as I let go and soar, becoming light, a simple mystery. Thank you.
day after I learned of Mark's passing was a very slow day. And I didn't sleep well, but woke early with a poem rattling in my mind. Not ready to get up completely, I just reached for a pen and scribbled it, thinking I'll take a look at it later. Later, when I looked at it, it was barely legible. But I took some time to straighten it out, and it became what is printed here, Death and the Hummingbird. Death and the dusting of life energy that remains as memory, love, grief suspended, the aching preciousness of life itself hovering for a moment. Oh, brilliance, joy flickering like a hummingbird visiting.
On piano in a second, and when he was playing it, for some reason some of the words of this T.S. Eliot poem came into my mind, and I was sort of happy to see that some of the themes are in Mark's own words. I'm going to read just a portion of what's written here. What we call the beginning is often the end. And to make an end is to make a beginning. The end is where we start from. And every phrase and every sentence is an end and a beginning. We die with the dying. See? They depart, and we go with them. We are born with the dead. See? They return and bring us with them. With the drawing of this bow and the voice of this calling, we shall not cease from exploration, and the end of all our exploring will be to arrive where we started and know the place for the first time. Through the unknown remembered gate, when the last of the earth left to discover is that which was the beginning. And all shall be well, and all manner of things shall be well, when the tongues of flame are enfolded, and the crowned knot of fire, and the fire and the rose are one.
In just a minute, I'm going to play something at the piano. You can see in the program that its title is Images and Reflections, Remembering Mark. As I contemplated my friend and the loss that I felt, I endeavored to translate it into what has become one of my native languages, and that's music. And although I've never been formally trained as a pianist or a music writer, I nonetheless played at the keyboard and assembled what would come to me. And each day, another fragment, and each fragment somehow a reflection or memory of Mark. After a couple of months, I had a potpourri of remembrances and images which I endeavored to assemble into a semi-coherent piece that perhaps I could give to him and to all of you today. The titles of the five sections, and each section is just a minute or two, have been given titles that I think will resonate with any of you who have even the slightest acquaintance with Mark
I want to read them. The first one, always forward and deeper, always in service to others. Waves, glimpses, and delights of a sparkling mind. Beauty at every turn, a world in a grain of sand. Wonder. Grieving, death, and the hummingbird. And if you've ever left a message on Mark's answering machine over these last decades, his outgoing message always said this: pray for peace, preach peace, practice peace. And then the refrain, always forward, because it never stopped. Always deeper, always in service to others. We'll see what happens next.
Thank you. Executive Director and Fellowship of Reconciliation. He came several times to All Souls, my Unitarian Church, for certain programs. And I was struggling with a particular issue. And Mark took the time to help me refocus on how I was going to deal with the issue. And that's just something Mark would naturally do.
Thank you, Linda. Any of you? Oh, Paul.
I'm humbled to be here to join in honoring Mark Johnson. When you get a chance to read the words in this program, you will see that the second sentence says, his lifelong fascination with ideas, history, nature, language, and people created networks that motivated and sustained him. Well, about 25 years ago, Mark came to Jane and myself with an idea. He had tentatively called this idea Silver Bay Institute. Well, before we got too much of a chance to flesh that out, two things happened. Number one, Brookside Cottage, right by Adams Brook, was pretty much condemned. And number two, Bruce Tamlin was ordinated. So that combination, we migrated to the Brookside Trinity Ministry and Spiritual Life Disorder. So you see, Mark Johnson was truly the father of both.
Others offer a thought, or please. Greg.
Hi, I'm Greg Belvedere. I'm Mark's son-in-law. It's weird. So I think the first time, like one of our first dates, something happened that, you know, gave me an inkling of who Mark was. We were having a conversation and we were at my place, and you know, I'm in the middle of talking about something, and I go, oh, there's this book I have about it, and I go to my bookshelf and get it, and Monica gives me this really strange look. And I'm like, what did I do? And she's like, my dad does that all the time. And so it was really great once I did start to get to know Mark, because I don't think I've ever met such like a compassionate, thoughtful person. And you know, unlike Mark, I do yell. And because I came from a household where, you know, you yell just, you know, talking at the dinner table. So Mark always gave me such a softness and a peacefulness that I really strive to emulate and usually fail. But
thank you.
Dave Burke from Silver Bay professional staff of the 1990s. It's been great to have a little mini reunion here of those folks. It was a really special time to work at Silver Bay and to be here year round, pre-internet, pre-cell phone, pre-Walmart, and different world. But recently when we were moving a lot of stuff around and I came across some old keepsakes that I kept from my time at Silver Bay, and one was a rather extraordinary set of memos that I had stapled together. And it was an exchange with Mark, and it started with me sending Mark a memo, because that's what we did back then. Mark was an early adopter. He had the first email account for everybody, and we all used his email originally. But anyway, I sent a typed memo to Mark expressing my disappointment in Silver Bay, and by extension, I guess, in him. And Sharon will remember some of this. It had to do with a publication that we had put out and how we were speaking about a particular issue of the day that was a controversial topic and connected to some of our programming. And I really felt that we didn't go far enough with that. And so I sent Mark this note expressing my disappointment very formally, 4 paragraphs long. And so when I was reading this recently, I was just struck by, first, just the embarrassment of the audacity of, like, having done this, you know, like, basically, who tells the executive director that you're disappointed in them, and that, you know, someone with impeccable peace and justice credentials to question them on a social issue. But what was more striking was, you know, and I should say I have to check myself now to think, how would I respond to some 20-year-old, you know, sending me such a note? And because Mark, it really speaks to, I think, the workplace that he created, where almost uniquely, I don't think since I, you know, have worked in a place where you would feel comfortable probably having that kind of direct communication. But Mark's response was, to each paragraph that I had typed, was a lengthy, handwritten, very thoughtful, patient response to each portion of my concern. And it was just really amazing. I looked at, think of the time that he took to respond and to really be thoughtful about various perspectives and kind of meeting people where they were, and how it was very instructive and very helpful in a latter career in administration. But he didn't let me off the hook there, because I think part of this this packet contained the next step, which was about a week or two later, Silver Bay received a complaint mail, a letter mail from a member who was very upset, probably on the opposite end of the spectrum for me on this particular topic, that Silver Bay had gone too far in the direction of in saying too much. You know, I've been concerned we hadn't said enough. And so Mark sent me the memo and asked me to draft his response. So I kept all of that. I mean, just a remarkable teachable moment. I think of when you talk about a mentor and a teacher, and to use that opportunity, and it was really instructive. As I said, meeting people where they are in an issue, and when I look back at it now, I'm just all the more amazed. So that's the person Mark was.
That's great. Thank you.
Let me just do this for a moment. Those that worked with Mark or worked on the staff when Mark was the director, please stand. All of you that were part of Mark's team in terms of that, look at all these folks. This is 20 years after he left. 20 years after he left. Thank you, everyone. It's a mini reunion for many of us, because we haven't seen each other in a while. It's so great to see these people gather again. Please, go ahead.
Okay, just to follow through on David Berg, Carol, Deanne, Mark Johnson inherited me when he came to Silver Bay as CEO. So we were total opposites, but somehow we made it work. And my responsibilities for Mark was to edit his communications when he left the office. And I thought, of all people, I am the last person in the world to review and edit his prose, etc. I charged for it, and I guess I did a good job. He never complained that much, but one day I struggled over a letter he had prepared, and he had sent it out to me,
to review. And mind you now, for you younger folks, this is before Google and before all this. We had dictionaries, we had a thesaurus, and that was about it. But anyway, I could not figure out what this man was saying. There was one word there, and I said, what is this? Couldn't find it anyplace, so I knock at his door. And I remember these words exactly. I said, Mr. God of words, what are you saying? What is this? And he looks at it and he says, Carol, that's da-da-da-da-da. And I said, but it's not in the dictionary. He said, well, it's not in there. He said, because it's new. I said, you're kidding. We can't send out new words. I said, oh, yes, we can. So, folks, I can't to this day remember what it was, but it's out there.
Thank you, Carol. Carol LePen and Mark are a team for many years together. So beautiful. Others that like to share, please.
So I'm Cindy Tess, and I was in the first,
Just hold on closer.
Hi, I'm Cindy Tess, and I was in the first EIT group when Mark and Mary were our leaders, and Alice and Monica, we were little babies, she was nursing it. Anyway, we got a letter from Mark and Mary before we showed up, and it said you needed to read the book Zen and the Art of
Motorcycle Maintenance.
See, I don't even know it because I didn't read it. But anyway, so I showed up along with probably all 20 of us, and I think I spoke to most people now, and I maybe McConaughey got it, but that was it. Anyway, so I kind of carried this burden with me for a really long time, and then on my dad's 80th surprise birthday party, Mark and Mary showed up. And I was like, you know what, I gotta do this now, you know? I'm just getting older. So I went up to them and admitted that I never read this book. You know, that we all kind of lie that we read it, and we didn't. So I got that off my chest. And of course, Mark said, there's still time. It wasn't too late, although it would have helped me over the last 40 years, right? So then Mark showed up last year, so allowed us to say goodbye to him. And I walked up, and he didn't say, hey, Cindy, how you doing, or anything. He goes, did you read it? And I will be honest, I still haven't.
Hey, thanks, Cindy. Stephanie Wagoner, current president, board president.
I just wanted to share with all of you that the Silver Bay Board of Trustees is really, really appreciative of the service that Mark and Mary and the entire Johnson family gave to this community during the time that you were with us. It's a lasting legacy. Bruce's comments demonstrated all of the things that happened on this campus while you were here. And I just wanted to say on behalf of our entire board, we are very, very grateful for your service to this community and your love for all of us. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. Faith.
One of the things that really struck me about Mark was that he never expected of anyone else what he didn't model himself. And the last conversation we had was when he was back here at Silver Bay, and we talked about climate change and his concern with that. But he was a genuine, caring, and loving human being, and nobody knows that better than his family. Thank you.
Others, there go, Barb, and then over here.
So many of you have had the honor and the privilege of having Mark visit you. I think, Carol, you probably, one of your jobs was to plan all of those itineraries all over the country, stopping in to see person after person after person. My parents were two of those people who were always honored by Mark's visits. And over the 10 or 12 years of his visiting, My father always had a folded-up check in his pocket and a pen with it, because he knew that a good CEO was also a fundraiser, and that a visit from Mark probably meant that he was going to ask for money. But Mark never asked for money. Mark always asked for love. And that's what you wrote the checks for. You wrote the checks for the love that Mark was bringing. So in the course of their meeting, Mark started talking about all the urns and ashes and whatever boxes of that they had in their cottage. And he had no idea what he was going to do with them. And my father's thinking, oh, where are we going with this? You know, like, I'm not going to take them and put them in my cottage. So he said, you know, to Mark, what are you going to do with this? And Mark said, and Bruce has alluded to it, I have an idea. I want to create something. My dad went, oh, that's great. You know, I think, what is it you want to create? And so he started to talk about the Memorial Garden. And still my parents weren't hooked into the whole thing until he said to my father, so where are you and Blanche planning on being buried? My father had his check out and his pen written right away. He was creating love.
Thank you, Barbara. Katie, Barbara, John, and Ann's
daughter. I'm going to say two things, and then I'm going to pass the mic to my mom, who she and Mark, Mary, and my dad were good friends. So first, this is for Brian. I graduated from high school in 1981, and I was fairly shy, and I came to Silver Bay for my first summer as an imp, and I was assigned the job as John Cleaner, and there was one other John Cleaner, and it was my sister, my older sister. You just shouldn't have done that, really. I don't know who thought that was a good idea, but... And obviously, by the end of the first week, Mark knew who I was and what my job was, because he memorized it. So, and he was also, I mean, he was program director, and I was just shy. He was intimidating. Don't you all think Mark was a very intimidating person? So, I'm at lunch, and outside with my friends, and here comes Mark, and I'm like, oh my gosh, he's heading towards my table. I hope he doesn't sit down. And, well, he did. He sat down next to me, and I'm like, I don't know what to say. And he turned around and immediately knocked my fruit punch all over me. And he had a gleam in his eye, so I think he planned that. There's the dirt. And that was not true. That was not true. That's the second thing is, my father was also the father of three daughters. My father never raised his voice, mostly, ever, except maybe to my mom. And so when we were in trouble, we were always scared of my mother.
Can you imagine she's intimidated by me? I have a short story to tell about Mark and my husband, John Barber. John and Mark were very good friends. They were buddies. And they planned all kinds of things for Silver Bay together. And one day, they decided that they would go out and travel across the country and visit where my husband had been born, which was all the way across the country, let me tell you. And they traveled and traveled, and they loved each other. I mean, they really got along together. And they got there, and John was YMCA. And his parents had been head of a YMCA in
No, not Mexico. Now I just have a blank moment. But it was across the country. Anyway, so they got there and they were visiting the Y that my husband John had been born in, and his father was the executive director of the Y there across the country.
Orlando, Florida.
No. He was born, John was born there. Anyway, they got there to reminisce about where he had been born, and they looked at the place, and they decided to spend the night in this YMCA. They ended up in a room, and much to my husband's horror, the sheets were filthy, the pillows were filthy, the whole place was falling apart, but it was still a YMCA. And since he'd been born and raised in a YMCA, he figured, well, I guess this is what where this was.
It was
tight. It could have been.
You're right. Fiona Calcutta.
Calcutta.
There, I finally got it together. Anyway.
Anyone else? Oh, please, Maria Crossman.
I'm Maria Crossman. I was a chaplain before Bruce was the chaplain.
Yes.
A long time ago. And I saw Mark a couple times every week, or days, or I need to tell you this because you need to know what's going on with the college kids who are telling me what's going on. And it was somewhat challenging at times. And then we got the chapel garden was built. And I had vespers that night, and I was supposed to be, you know, being meaningful. And I was. You know, I talked about the difference between energy that makes it, you know, white clothes, that all kinds of stuff. Anyway, and then I went out into the garden, and Mark was there. And I looked at the plants that had just been planted in the garden, and I said, Mark, those flowers are pink. I had spent hours putting together a 5-minute speech on white flowers. And I said, what, they're pink, come on, this is ridiculous. Do you know one of those pink flowers is still out there? Been blooming for however many years it's been there. I looked at him and I said, I don't know what I'm going to do. And he said, oh, just talk about colors, white, that are, the words are escaping from me right now. But it was, you know, he got it together for me so I could figure out that it would work. My little speech talking about the chapel garden. Chapel garden has been something that matters a great deal to me. And I realize today I've had a terrible time dealing with this situation of, you know, Mark's not being with us anymore. And it's all about the chapel garden. It's all about what that means to the people around us, to the things that are important to us, the differences that we can each make with each other as we learn to cope with our loss. And it didn't dawn on me until about 10 minutes ago that I, like everybody else, has a loss in this. It's not my personal problem. It belongs to all of us.
Thanks, Maria. Sharon Offer.
I'm Sharon, and I worked with Mark along with so many others here. When I walked into this auditorium, there's a memory that I've held for many years. And it was when one of the writers in Writer's Voice, if it were not for Mark Johnson, we wouldn't have been blessed with all these writers. And I'm looking at Joel and Dave and everybody who celebrated that. But it was a writer from Utah, a naturalist, Terry Tempest Williams, came into town, and she spoke at that podium. And everyone was, she started her writing, her reading, and a storm came through. It was violent. And you couldn't really hear her words. And she stepped away from the podium, and everyone in these seats went out on the porch and listened. It was amazing. And when it stopped, everyone came back, and she proceeded with the reading. But those experiences I had all the time when I was here, and Mark had, I remember he asked me to come to take do some work with the Writer's Voice, and he said, it's only gonna be 5 hours a week. Yeah. And he had such faith that I could do this, and I didn't have it in myself, as is often the case. And he, without him, I mean, he brought writers here nationally, locally, regionally, and more importantly, he brought local writers into the Adirondack schools, hundreds of them. And these students got a chance to be with a writer and learn. And his passion for writing, for reading, is with me every day. And he will be missed, and he is loved.
Thank you, Sharon.
I'm Henry Caldwell. I was at Worcester when Mark was there. So was my brother. I did not know Mark at Worcester. I did not know Mark at Silver Bay, but I knew Mark from the board of the Lake George Land Conservancy. And Mark was the chairman of the board of the Land Conservancy during some major acquisitions. Of course, you talked about the Rowan Preserve, but it's amazing. I have no knowledge of Mark's experiences here in Silver Bay, but boy, he did so much for Lake George. And I want to thank Mark for what he did for Lake George.
Hi, my name is Tony Hall. I first met Mark in the summer of 1998 when I became editor of the Lake George Mirror. And Mark, of course, was a great source. I remember reaching him on his cell phone as he was on a train coming up from New York, because I'd heard a rumor that George Pataki really loved Mark and wanted him to be chairman of the Lake George Park Commission. And Mark was kind enough to take my call and, in fact, confirm that, so we had at least the equivalent of a local scoop. And I think for a brief moment, the Lake George Park Commission had the potential to become a really progressive environmental agency under Mark, as opposed to what sometimes it's referred to as a local chamber of commerce. And of course, not long after, in 2001, Mark was offered the position that led him to leave Silver Bay. And I had come to like Mark not only as a news source, but as one of those people that you really could talk to about anything. Anything you had wanted to start thinking about, he had already thought through to the conclusion. And there are not many people like that. So it was with some, you know, disappointment that, you know, I asked Mark about why he was leaving. And everyone has talked about how warm Mark was, but he was not sentimental. And he said to me that he had always said that where the mission took him, that's where he would be. And I've, oddly enough, always found that to be very consoling, because as I'm, you know, now entering my 25th, 26th year of editing the late George Mirror, many fascinating and wonderful people have come and gone. And just Mark's words have helped me adjust to that and to benefit from these people. And I can't help extend the metaphor and the analogy that it's some consolation on a day like today as well.
Thank you.
Hello? Sorry, might get emotional. Many of you know Mark, a ton to me. And I put something down here, but I want to start it out with Mark made us all better. He made this place better. He made me better. And this is what I wrote to him when I got to come up and visit him and Mary last fall. And so this is inspired by Mark's life. It's called conscious leadership. Consciousness is about becoming. It's about growing up, maturing, surrendering, striving, failing, learning, listening, patience, conscientiously objecting. It's about standing up for one's beliefs and for our sisters and brothers. It's about stepping back, slowing down, and surrounding others on their journey. It's about self-awareness, other awareness, and respect for both. It's about our one world with beautiful people. It's about human issues, human development, spiritual development, leadership development. It's about being contemplative and not dualistic. It's about being broken and whole. It's about going ongoing transformation through service. It's about attention being the ticket of admission. It's about everything eventually having an end. Probably should edit that last piece, because I think Mark will live on in all of us, making us a better people, and this place a better place. Thank you.
Thank you. So we'll have an opportunity to share more stories with one another as we move out into the lawn, but we have a beautiful slideshow that the family's put together that we would like to share.
Shadows are falling and I'm running out of breath. Keep me in your heart for a while. If I leave you, it doesn't mean I love you any less. Keep me in your heart for a while. When you get up in the morning and you see that crazy sun, keep me in your heart for a while. There's a train leaving nightly called when all is said and done. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sometimes when you're doing simple things around the house, maybe you'll think of me and smile. You know I'm tied to you like the buttons on your blouse. Keep me in your heart for a while. Hold me in your thoughts. Take me to your dreams. Touch me as I fall into view. And when the winter comes, keep the fires lit, and I will be right next to you. Engine drivers headed north to Pleasant Stream. Keep me in your heart for a while. These wheels keep turning, but they're running out of steam. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la-la. Keep me in your heart for a while. Sha. Thank you.
How about we all stand up?
Stir me from blood.
Thank you so much. Hey, let's have a seat for a moment. We'll finish up our service here. We have a closing prayer, commendation, and we'll sing a verse or two of Amazing Grace. So let us pray together. Oh, gracious God, we give you thanks for your servant, Mark Johnson, whose life we have celebrated today. He gave fully of himself, holding nothing back. He touched the lives of so many with his faithful service, his commitment to peace and justice, and his loving presence. We know that his light continues to shine in this world, and that his spirit serves to encourage and inspire our lives and the lives of tens of thousands of others. Oh Lord, how grateful we are for the life of Mark Johnson. How privileged we are for having known him, having worked with him, called him friend, served a cause with him, served on a board with him, called him my brother, my dad, my grandpa, or husband. Lord, each of our lives has been uplifted and enriched by your servant Mark. Gracious God, we are grateful that Mark has left us with much to think about, much to ponder, much to consider when reflecting on our own witness to a life of service. Mark does not want us to wallow in our grief, but we ask, Lord, that you would walk with us and comfort us in this time of loss. And Lord, I especially ask that you be with Mary and Monica and Allison and Anne and their families at this time of loss. Gracious God, we close our prayer by honoring Mark and remember him as a loving person and a faithful witness to your love, forgiveness, and mercy. And we do this by saying the prayer that you have taught us to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So gracious God, we commend the spirit of your servant, Mark Johnson, into your loving arms this day. You have assured us the gift of eternal life. To this promise, we commend the spirit of Mark to live with you in peace and joy for all eternity. So receive your servant Mark and welcome him into the company of heaven, into the fellowship of the saints, to live with you in the kingdom of God, now and always. Amen, amen. And everyone together said,
Amen.
Let's just sing we'll just stay seated, sing two beautiful verses, first and last of Amazing Grace. Amazing Grace, 378 in your hymnal. Let us go forth in the love of God who created us in the mercy of Jesus Christ who redeemed us, in the power of the Holy Spirit who strengthens us. May the heavenly host sustain us and the company of heaven enfold us. May we go in peace to love and to serve in the spirit of the life of Mark Charles Johnson, whose life we have celebrated today. We offer this benediction in your holy name. Amen, amen, and everybody together said amen.
Amen.
We need to do one more thing. I would ask you to join me and Mary and family in giving Mark the standing ovation he deserves for such a life so well lived. Please join us. Standing. Opportunities, some food, some fellowship. Thank you so much for being here. Have a great rest of the day, and we give thanks to God for Mark Johnson.